Hello, welcome back to the channel, and welcome to this third part of my tutorial series about this character and how we build it for Adobe Character Animator. If you haven't seen the first two parts of this, I heavily recommend you click on this link right here in the upper right corner. And today in this part, we are going to finally get everything out of Blender, where we illustrated everything, and into Photoshop first, to roughly set it up, to arrange all the layers, do the folders, to then to be imported into Character Animator. Then we are going to look into some rigging. And I mentioned before, this is going to be a three-part tutorial series, but actually it's going to be a four-part series because there's so much to cover here. If you want to support me and my channel, please check out my Gumroad link in the description. You can find the files from this tutorial there and also some of my puppets. So let's get started. We're gonna have to set up a couple of things first before we can export everything as single images. I'm gonna disable the auto lock feature for the layers here. Then I'm going to, by pressing I and hovering over these little numbers, which is the opacity, I'm gonna create a keyframe for every single layer for the opacity being at 1. Then I go over to the next frame, I turn on auto keyframing down there, and I'm gonna turn everything to 0, which will automatically create a keyframe with 0 opacity. And now we're going to go into Dope Sheet and select everything, press T, select constant, and this is how we prevent any kind of interpolation between our keyframes. You should also do this when you finished all of your keyframing right before you export, so there is no interpolation at all. I want to have my layers off, on, off, so I shift everything over to the right, copy my last keyframe, which is 0, to the first position, and now I have a 0 opacity keyframe, 1 and 0 again. And this way, I can just make every single layer or every single element visible for one frame. And for the glasses here, which have 3 frames, because they're animated, I will just extend the visibility to 3 frames, as you can see here. So now I'm going down in the layer order. I'm looking for my element. In this case, for example, it's the nose. I have a fill layer and outline layer. I'm going to push them over to where there's no visible frame yet. And I'm going to go down and do this with every single element I want to have on a single frame. Sometimes the fill and the outline layer are not right below each other, so this is why this looks a little bit messed up right here. And here you can see it once again. Now we're at the ones that have a visibility longer than 1 frame, so we're going to extend it to 3 frames. Pushing this over, so now it's in the range of visibility of this layer. And the same goes for all the other ones. And in the end, I'm creating a reference layer where you just have the puppet in its rest state. You don't really need that, but I'm going to do this here. Setting everything to 50 frames. So we're going to export 50 frames. Now we can check how it looks. And this is how it plays out if you've done everything correctly. Every single element has 1 frame now, which means for all of these frames, we will have an image later. Now we have to go into the output settings, set everything to 4K, which is already the case here. 12 frames is already the case. And we're gonna check the color management. And since we created a preset from Blender's file menu, it's already on RGB, which is correct. By hitting F12, we can see a test render of our puppet. It looks fine. Let's check the render settings up here. These settings are fine. You can even set it higher. The only thing we have to do now is go into film and see that it's transparent because we want to have transparency. The only thing left to do is go to output settings, set the output path, choose a location, and then we want to have PNG, that's correct. RGBA means we want to include alpha channel, we go to 16-bit, and we don't want to have any compression at all. And now you can go to render animation up here in the render menu. If you click it, you will see everything's gonna get rendered and you will find an image sequence in the folder you specified. And now we're in Photoshop, go to File, Scripts, Load Files into Stack, find our folder where we exported everything to, select everything, open it, sort by name. Then we go to OK, and it will start loading everything as layers into Photoshop, which is perfect for us. So now I'm going to start and name every single layer in Photoshop and put them into folders. I'm going to disable all of these except this first one. And here we're dealing with the glasses, which have three states. The first one being the states where they are down in front of the eyes. Everything goes into a folder, we call it shades. And then I want to put the second and the third one into their own folder so I can animate those later in Character Animator. Now we're going to go through all of the layers and name them. I'm going to use some naming conventions that are used in Character Animator, but what you shouldn't do, which I'm doing here, is call everything mouth neutral or smile or anything, because mouth and neutral, both of those words are actually tags in Character Animator. We don't want these layers tagged as mouth or neutral. So here I found out, okay, my e-mouth is supposed to look different. So I'm correcting this really quickly in Photoshop. And I'm looking at the Character Animator mouth shapes while I'm doing this. Now I put everything in a folder. Call it mouth. Now we just go down a line in the layer order, the blink overlays for the eyes. Pupils. Eyebrows. And we continue with the eyes. And this is just a boilerplate setup which we're creating here. So it's roughly set up for Character Animator. And most likely we will have to come back for some things into Photoshop and tweak them. And also we will tweak a lot of things inside of Character Animator. And these are the gestures, and I'm not going to name them. It's enough to name the folder. It's enough to identify them later. And the frames inside of them, we are not going to touch them so much, so they don't have to be named. So everything now, all the layers, they go into one folder, which is the character folder. It needs to have a plus in front of it. And now inside of it, I'm going to create folders for the eyes. I already created one for the mouth. Going to order left and right accordingly. And create folders for eye left and eye right. Now these things all go into the head group. Everything that belongs to the head, call it head. I'm going to turn on the shades and turn off the animation. And the rest of the layers go into a folder called body. And this is most of the time the structure of any kind of character animator puppet. Now I go in, take all the left arm states, put them in the arm left folder. Same goes for the right arm. Now we're done with everything. We have everything set up. The only thing you can do is mark the area which is covered by the character and its gestures, and then go to image, crop, and crop it so it doesn't take up so much space. And now we are finally in Adobe Character Animator. We press File, Import, look for our puppet, the PSD file we created. Import it, and there it is. Next thing we do is select the puppet and press the little create scene icon so we can have our first scene. It's already reacting to our motion on the camera, but you can see there's still a lot of stuff to do here. And now we should set it to 4K because that's what it's supposed to be in. And also what you don't see me doing here, I'm gonna set this whole thing to 12 frames per second. Double click on the puppet icon. One problem you might run into is, you see, I have the face selected here and the bounding box for it is way bigger than the actual face. This means there are some pixels somewhere there on this layer that shouldn't be there. So I select the whole face, invert the selection and delete everything that surrounds it, and that should fix it. With the body layer selected, we choose the stick tool, put a stick on the feet and tag it with fixed. And now you can see it's already kind of working. The feet are fixed in place. Now we have the head selected. We're going to move the origin down to where the neck is. On the right side is tagged as a head. That's good. We go to the scene and everything seems to work. But if you look closely, you're going to see that the head is actually being distorted, which I don't want. So what we can do about it is go back into the puppet panel and try to add an independent crown to the head. But what this does is actually makes the whole head independent from the whole body. So actually that is not what we want. So we should go back into the puppet panel and remove the independent crown. What we should do instead is go to the actual face layer and tell it to maintain its shape by adding a crown to it. And now the head folder is still working as a control layer for the whole body while the face is being maintained in its shape. So now we're gonna create a swap set by clicking on this little plus icon here, and that will create two triggers for us. And we will be able later to press those triggers and switch between those two elements, shades one and shades up. And on the shades up layer or the folder, we're gonna add the behavior cycle layers, which will enable us to animate through those layers. They will actually be cycled through by character animator. I'm gonna put this to two frames. I will return to one actually later again. And we're gonna tell it to forward and reverse the animation and hold on last layer. Which means in this case, I'm gonna set this whole thing to actually latch to shades up. So I press the key once and they will be up. And if I press it again, they will come down again. You can see that here. I press it, comes up, press it again, comes down. So here we are with the mouth folder, which has all the viseems in it. And what happened here, because they all have mouth and neutral in their names, character animator actually automatically tags them as mouth and neutral, which they are not. So we should remove all of them. Also, I have less viseems than character animator offers. So some of the triggers you see here on the right side share one viseme, like for example here, A and A. And also O and R, same goes for S and D. One thing I didn't do was put the smile and the neutral mouth into a folder because I want to be able to also swap those two by pressing a key. And I'm going to call this neutral. And this has both of the layers inside, so I can actually add a swap set and switch between them. Back in character animator, same with the glasses, I will add a swap set. We will get the same result. We will have a trigger set down here. I'm going to rename it. And I'm going to have to remove the tags again because they were created again in character animator. And I'm going to add the Y as a key to trigger it. And now you can see it actually works. What I also want to do is make it latch, so I just have to press it once and then I press it again to not smile anymore. Next thing is the eyebrows. I'm going to tag the eyebrows here on the right accordingly. I'm going to see, yeah, they work, but they're distorting the head. Why is that? Because the eyebrows are not independent. So they should be independent, so they move freely. We're going to set everything. We're going to fine tune everything later. Because the wrinkle on the forehead behaves like an eyebrow, I will also make it independent and tag it as an eyebrow too. And this is going to mess everything up, but we're going to fix that later. Now we're going to work on the eyes. And if we wouldn't make those pupils independent, they would actually act the same as we saw with the eyebrows earlier. They would just distort the face or the eyes. So we have to make them independent and tag them as pupils, of course, so the actual eye gaze behavior knows that these are the pupils. The eyes are actually tagged as eyes, so the same behavior knows in which area the pupil is supposed to move. And for the blink behavior, which is, by the way, already applied on the character automatically, I have to change how I set up everything in Photoshop. I need to have two elements which I can swap between in each eye folder, which I'm doing here. And now I can swap between them in Character Animator, the blink state and the non-blink state. And you can see that it already works. But I have to do the tags again, because whenever you reload anything from Photoshop, sometimes it resets everything. Now we're going to set up the jaw. And for that, I'm going to use the stick tool, having the face selected. I'm going to put one where the upper teeth are and one where the jaw is. Tag that as a jaw and go up to the upper one and say that is fixed, because I don't want it to move. If we go back now, we see that it works, but later on we will tweak it a little bit. All right, pretty exciting. After two parts of this tutorial video, we finally made it into Character Animator. We set up our head, and in the next video we're going to look into rigging the rest of the body, setting up all the behaviors and fine-tuning them. And at the end of that, we are actually going to record a little sequence with our finished puppet. Please check out my Gumroad page if you want to support me, where you can actually download the final version of this puppet and many other ones I made. And please consider subscribing to the channel. See you next time.